But welcome to, I'm Professor Nick Hardiker. I'm Associate Dean for Research and Enterprise in the School of Human and Health Sciences at the University of Huddersfield. And I'd like to welcome you to this evening's In Conversation webinar, which focuses on the importance of looking after your lower legs. So before I introduce the speakers, I just wanted to say a couple of things about the School of Human and Health Sciences. We're the largest school in the university. We've got four departments and we've got seven research centres, and we play host to a dynamic multidisciplinary research environment, hoping to support world-class research excellence, providing significant local and international impact. So our vision is to co-create and implement knowledge for real public benefit, and we're going to hear about an institute which is at the vanguard of that. So let's move on to our speakers. Tonight's session is with our Professor and Director of the Skin Integrity and Infection Prevention Institute here at the University. The Institute's one of the jewels in our research crown, so to speak. Karen, I'm going to read this because there's so many accolades that I'm going to miss them otherwise. Karen's visiting professor at Queensland University of Technology in Australia, also in Australia, Swinburne University of Technology, and the Royal College of Surgeons for Ireland, and she's fellow of the Royal Society of Biology. Currently, she's a member of the National Wound Care Strategy. Her research interests naturally focus on skin integrity, infection prevention, management of surgical site complications, and improving access to education for all healthcare professionals and service users. Dr. Leanne Atkin is a vascular nurse consultant at Mid Yorkshire Hospitals NHS Trust, a lecturer practitioner also within the school at the University of Huddersfield, and a council member of the Society of Vascular Nurses. She's currently the chair of Legs Matter campaign to increase awareness, understanding and action on lower leg and foot conditions among the public and healthcare professionals. So in tonight's session, Karen will tell you more about the Institute and the research she's undertaking, the Institute's undertaking, and Leanne will tell you more about the Legs Matter campaign. We'll have some time, conversations permitting, towards the end for questions. So please pop any questions you have, any comments you have in the chat associated with the Zoom meeting, and one of the team will pick them up and field them to me. So I'll see you later, but I'll hand you now over to Karen and Leanne.
Thank you, Nick. I'm going to attempt to share my screen now. That's gone dreadfully wrong when I was practicing, so I do hope it does work for everybody. And I'm hoping everybody can see that. Excellent. So we're going to talk about why legs matter, but first of all, I would like to be able to tell you a little bit about the Institute. So the Institute itself is called the Institute of Skin Integrity and Infection Prevention. And obviously, by nature of its title, this is what we're interested in, all things to do with skin and all things to do with infection. It's an international and interprofessional institute, and we're actually really proud of it because it brings together academics, practitioners, international and national experts, and service users. And from within the university, we have five schools that are involved within this institute. So we've got computing and engineering, art, design and architecture, applied sciences, law and human and health. And many of you may be thinking, well, what's engineering or computing or art, design and architecture got to do with skin? Well, it's all about the expertise that we have within the university itself. And all these people are interested in skin and how to improve outcomes for patients. So for example, our engineering department can look at what skin's made of, and how it works against friction and shear. So for example, if you sat in a chair and you're moving around, sometimes you feel quite uncomfortable, so you'll lift your bottom up, and we can look at how the skin is affected on chairs by moving up and down. Or when we look in clinical practice, how this affects people who are laid in bed for a long period of time. It's also very important to us that the research we do has positive outcomes for patients, carers, relatives, and of course, staff. So we can do what we call blue sky research, which is doing a lot of research within a university and looking at things that are going to happen in maybe 10 years' time. But what we want to really do is look at what is a real issue for patients at the moment and what's an issue for our clinical practitioners. So we really do want to work closer with the clinicians so they can come to us and say, we've got a real issue with surgical site infection, for example, or with lower limb disease. And then we can work together and try and improve outcomes for those patients. So it's all about bringing research and evidence to the bedside rather than just keeping it within the university itself. So to ensure that we're able to share our research and expertise, people like Leanne and myself write a lot of best practice documents and consensus documents that are available free of charge to download from wound sites, including Wounds UK, Wounds International, Journal of Wound Care, and the European Wound Management Association. So people can look at this and be able to update themselves and educate themselves on what's best practice. And a lot of these documents focus on the lower limb as well. So if you have a look at the Wounds UK website, or you look at the European Wound Management Association website, you'll see many documents that have been written by Leanne, myself, and other members of the Institute to help improve those outcomes for patients. So at the moment, we're very interested in looking at a range of different research areas. And obviously the pandemic over the last 12 months has really highlighted areas that we can help within clinical practice. So we've been looking at personal protective equipment and how this affects skin. And we've looked at masks, both the masks that are worn in hospitals and the masks that are worn by the general public as face coverings, and how we can prevent the skin damage that some of these are causing. And over the last 12 months, you will have seen lots and lots of pictures and videos and images of healthcare professionals that have got all this skin damage around the nose and up the cheeks. So we're looking at how can we develop masks that can help prevent that. So can we, for example, scan people's faces and be able to develop bespoke masks so that we don't have this skin damage? What we've noticed is a lot of masks have been developed for Western faces like myself and Leanne's faces. But for people that live in the Far East, for example, so Filipino nurses and people that come from that area of the world, their faces are a lot smaller than ours and they're having great difficulty keeping these masks in place. So that's what we're looking at. We're also very interested in skin tears, as you can see from this image in front of you. And these are so common, but are often overlooked because people will say, it's just a skin tear. Why are you worrying about it? But you can see from this image, they're really quite serious, these skin tears. So we need to be looking at how can we educate people in the general public on how to manage these and how to prevent them. And also, who is your first point of contact? And again, over the past 12 months, we've seen that people are quite worried about going into hospital or trying to get an appointment at the general practitioners. So we've been within the Institute working really close with our pharmacy colleagues to try and update them and educate them on how to manage skin tears. And one of the biggest things we have been looking at is antimicrobial resistance and antimicrobial stewardship. And for people who may think, what does that mean? It's about the effective use and appropriate use of antibiotics and also some of the dressings that we use in clinical practice. So many of you will have used dressings that have got silver impregnated into them. But we're looking at how the body is becoming is good at managing these, but some of the bugs that we see, these super bugs that you hear being spoken about, they become very intelligent at looking at silver and thinking, no, we can bypass these silver dressings. So we need to be really careful and very aware of which dressings we can use. And the World Health Organization has also brought out quite a lot of information that we're using within our research about how to manage antimicrobial resistance. and improve antimicrobial stewardship, which is all about nurses, doctors, healthcare professionals, patients and relatives being aware that we don't always need an antibiotic to manage viruses, for example, or we don't always need an antimicrobial dressing to manage a wound. And just for interest, by 2050, if we haven't managed to reduce the amount of inappropriate antibiotics and antimicrobial wound dressings, there'll be more deaths caused by antimicrobial resistance and by cancer. So you can see what a huge area this is that needs investigating. And within the Institute, we're trying to investigate this and be able to develop education programs to help people, as well as research that can help us choose different wound dressings that are maybe non-medicated. So we're looking at lots of different things, but very much interesting. What would you like us to look at if you've got a real issue in practice? And if you want to work with us, to please contact us, and we're always happy to have a chat or a discussion. So one of the members of the Institute is who I'm in conversation with this evening, and it's Dr. Leanne Atkin. Leanne is a vascular nurse consultant and also a lecturer practitioner here at the university. She's both a national and international specialist and key opinion leader on lower limb disease. And she's the chair of the Legs Matter campaign, that is a national campaign here in England. She's also an inviting member of the National Wound Care Strategy Programme. And Leanne was instrumental in producing the lower limb guidance that is free to download for anybody from the National Wound Care Strategy Programme website, which will be in the chat box. She's also a member of the All Parliamentary Committee for Venous and Vascular Disease. And I'm absolutely delighted that Leanne not only works with the Institute, but works with me as well. And she's able to be in conversation with us tonight. So I will hand over to Leanne to give you a little bit of an outline of what we're going to talk about and about Legs Matters.
Hi, Karen. Thank you so much for that lovely introduction. I am a clinical academic, we call us in the new world. So I work within a hospital 3 days a week, but also at the university 2 days a week. And this real blend of this clinical academic brings so many advantages to so many different points. Like Karen says, it enables us to think of those questions at the university that is lacking research evidence, but then able me to bring that research to life with recruiting patients within the NHS. But actually personally, and the bit that I love the best, is disseminating that new knowledge, that new information, both to my patients, but also to my colleagues and my students within the university. Because we need to ensure that we are making the workforce of the future as skilled and as knowledgeable as possible, because they're facing a huge clinical challenge at this moment in time. But I do think I have got the best job in the entire world, so I am very, very fortunate. I'm also very proud to be the chair of the Legs Matters campaign, and that's what I'm here to talk about with you this evening. Legs Matters came about a few years ago because there's a number of societies throughout the whole of the UK, Tissue Viability Society, Society of Vascular Nurses, College of Podiatrists, Accelerate CIC. And all of these people were really wanting to improve the quality of care for patients across the UK, and Legs Matters covers the whole of the UK, not just England, to really start to improve the quality of care that these patients received. But we decided to do this by coming together of a number of health professional organisations under one coalition called Legs Matter, to try to really increase that awareness and the understanding of the need for action when your patient has got lower limb issues, either that on the leg or on the foot. And actually, we thought that our campaign needed to target the healthcare professional, because we always need to improve standards. But actually, our campaign was very unique because it focused on the public, because we wanted to raise the bar in terms of what should a person expect for care of their lower limb. Because unfortunately, we heard many stories of, I've tried to access help, but I was just poo-pooed or simply dismissed of what I was experiencing. So that's why Legs Matters were formed. Next slide, Karen. So in terms of Legs Matters, we have a few things that we want to get out there within the public domain. So first thing, across the whole of the UK, leg and foot wounds are one of the biggest NHS challenges that we're currently facing. Around 1 million people at this moment in time has got a non-healing wound on their lower limb. That's a massive amount of people. We need to get patients experiencing the right care at the right time, because we know already from an evidence base of what patients need to be treated with, but the problem is actually translating that to everyday clinical practice. And we need to raise the awareness and the understanding of, if we don't treat things right first time, well, actually we're just elongating patient suffering and actually escalating the burden to the NHS. And we believe that we can work much more effectively working together than working alone. And that's the reason why I've joined Professor Ousey tonight to have a conversation about lower limb wounds and lower limb conditions, to see really if we can bring home some of the confounding factors, both to the public and also to any professionals that's listening out there. So a lot of what I'm going to be talking about today is to give generalist education, advice about lower limb conditions. But I'd just like you all to drop down the website address for legsmatters.org. We have a huge amount of resources within our web pages. We have help and information directly targeted for patient, family and friends. And we have that same information worded in a slightly different way to healthcare professionals. Now, we're not saying that if you're a patient, you can't read the health professional, but we've just slightly toned down some of his language to make it a bit more understandable for you. So there's some great resources on there for both professionals and the patients. So Karen, I'm happy to start our conversation. So I suppose over to you.
Yes, thank you, Leanne. And you know, it's really interesting to listen to this. It's such a great thing, Legs Matter. But it's so sad it's taken everybody to come together to highlight this out there, because we've got legs and we all get aching legs, and we worry a lot, I think, sometimes about, is it right? Is it not right? But then sometimes people don't worry about things and they don't really understand about how the leg works, because we just get up in the morning and think, off we go. So could you tell us a little bit about the circulation of the leg, veins, arteries, why we might get legs that lymphedema legs, and what happens?
So in the easiest of forms, there is really three systems of the lower leg. The arteries that feed the blood down to the lower limbs, so that's from the heart, down the aorta, down the iliac vessels, down the femoral arteries, right down to the arteries of the foot. And it's the arteries that keep the foot alive, the muscles working, and all the nutrients that you need to keep that foot healthy. And if you start to get problems with your arteries, you can get things like pain when you're walking, a feeling of cold feet. And at the end of that scenario, you can end up with gangrene and tissue loss. The other system that we need to mention is the veins. So actually, this is the blood system that takes the blood from the foot back up to the heart. And many of you will know about issues with veins, because varicose veins are very common indeed. But varicose veins mostly are just a cosmetic problem, but sometimes it can start to cause you symptoms like tired and achy legs, a feeling of heaviness, and that can result in pain. And across the UK, we are still offering procedures for symptomatic varicose veins to help with those. But if veins go wrong tremendously and the pressure within the veins increases, we can start to get changes within the skin. And when we start to get changes within the skin, we have the movement of the blood products that should be within the vein into the tissues of the lower limb. And if you think about the three major blood products, there's red blood cells that can leak into the surrounding subcutaneous tissue. And many people may find that on their lower leg, especially around their ankle, they have brown staining that looks like big, odd brown freckles. That's actually the hemoglobin, the iron content of the red blood cell that's being deposited within that tissue. And it's called hemosiderin staining. But that's an indication that there may well be a problem with your veins. The second blood product that often gets leaked out is actually plasma, water. And that's why many patients start to suffer with soft pitting edema, again around the ankle, worse on episodes of dependency. And again, it can be a problem with the veins or a problem with the lymphatics. And remember, the lymphatics is the drainage system that carries away the excess fluid, if you like, from the lower limb. And the third blood product is white blood cells. And white blood cells, when deposited into that space of the tissue, can start to cause chronic inflammation. So you can get itchy skin, dry skin, irritated skin. And the end of that pathway is when you develop a leg ulcer. So it's really important that we don't view leg ulcers as just a leg ulcer. We have to understand the underlying systems that's involved in that. It's very much like chopping a dandelion's head off in your garden. There's no point in just putting a dressing on top of the dandelion's head. We really need to think of what's happening to the underlying structures, those veins, in terms of like removing the roots from the weed. So in essence, to the answer to your question, there's arteries that take the blood from the heart to the foot, veins that return the blood from the foot to the heart, and also mixed in with that is a lymphatic drainage system to help to remove excess plasma or water from the lower leg, and it also helps with our immune system as well.
Leanne, that's really interesting. Something that's just made me think about things is what you've just said about leg ulcers. So we're quite reactive, I think, as humans. So we look at our legs and think, oh, I've got a sore there, or I've got an ulcer, I better go to the GP or go to the pharmacy or the nurse. But we really should be trying to prevent these leg ulcers occurring in the first place. So can you tell me a little bit about what people should be worried about? Because we hear a lot, you talked about staining on the leg, so people may look at that and think, oh yeah, that's not right, so I'll go to the GP. But I do think we hear a lot of patients say my legs ache, or when I get in bed at night, I need to drop my leg out of the bed and then it feels better. So can you tell us a little bit about what we should be looking at and what should be worrying us?
I think that's a really good point, Karen. And one of the reasons why we set up Legs Matters is that as a group of clinicians involved in that, we heard many a tale that patients come to us in clinic with a leg ulcer, who reported 6 months ago the talks of the GP that they had really problems with their varicose veins and they were starting to get edema and skin changes. And it took that knock on the car door before actually anything happened. And it does feel like we missed the chance of prevention on early intervention with those. And it's the same as the pain that you can get when you've got problems with your arteries. These things can be, and patients don't need to simply learn to live with these conditions. Within Legs Matters, we've done a fantastic 3-point health check for your lower legs. That's all you need to do. And we talk about number one, skin. Looking at the condition of the skin for changes of colour, for dryness, for knocks and sores, for fissures in the heels that we need to tackle urgently, for any wounds that's not healing. We talk about the shape of the lower leg as number two. You shouldn't have edema on your lower leg. If you've got edema, there's a reason for that. We need to unpick that underlying cause and actually try to prevent the edema from getting worse. Because over time, edema will go from soft and retractable to fibrotic and stiff, and then we will get significant skin changes that will be irreversible. So there's a time window to change the shape and the size of your leg. And the third thing, the third point check, so we talk about the skin, the shape, is the feel. And it's actually asking you, what are your symptoms? What is bothering you? Is it that tired and achiness at the end of the day, more likely to be your veins? Is it a pain in the muscle of your back of your leg after you're walking for about 200 yards? A pain that forces you to stop, goes away after a period of rest? That's more likely to be indicative of a problem with the arteries. And that specific pain is called intermittent claudication. Or is that pain simply that's happening on a night time within the muscles, that the legs feel restlessness and you get classic muscular cramp where you feel like your toes are interlocking? That's very common indeed and nothing to be worried about. But there are some interventions that you can do to help that. So it's really important that you think about the feel of your legs and try to discuss or find some help to look at that specific problem that you are experiencing. But I think the challenge, Karen, and the reason why we do these types of conversation is actually getting through to a clinician that's prepared to do something, that's not going to simply to poo-poo you. We hear and you know, your passion for antimicrobial resistance and the problems with over-prescription of antibiotics. Most skin changes get dealt with by a general practitioner out in community with a course of flucloxacillin as the first close of consultation, when actually those antibiotics are not going to work, because if you remember, I talked about inflammation within the cells, not infection. So we need to dampen down that internal inflammatory response by looking at what is the underlying cause.
And I think, Leanne, there is a real issue here. And sadly, you've just mentioned antimicrobial resistance now, but it is trying to get people to understand the difference between inflammation and infection, and they are quite different. And I don't think sometimes the pandemic's helped a lot, because people relying on telephone consultations or telehealth. But if people say, oh, my leg's really red and it's itching and it hurts, then people will think, oh, it must be infected, when in fact it's not, it's inflammation. Like, say, you need to put your creams on there, you need to put your compression on and maybe elevate your legs. So there is lots of things joined together, and we can't just talk about a leg ulcer. We also have to ensure that people know about inflammation and infection.
I think what COVID has done though, Karen, in terms of the antimicrobial resistance, I think it has scared the entire world of what it's like to have a disease with no known therapeutic. And actually, like you said, if we continue down the line with antimicrobial resistance, we are going to be in that position with a normal pneumonia, a cellulitis, an eye infection with no known therapeutic. What would the world look like with that? In terms of the COVID pandemic, yes, it's been a challenge. I've worked throughout it within the NHS, but can I tell you, my clinics has run completely face-to-face on a weekly basis with no problems at all. The NHS is still open. The access point in terms of primary care may have changed slightly, that may be done by video consultation or by telephone to try to avoid the chance of cross-infection. But the NHS is still open, especially secondary care. We're still there for you.
I also think there's, we also have to look at different roles that people can play as well. So it's the general public as well needs to understand about leg ulcers and how to look after your legs. But I do think our podiatry colleagues and our pharmacy colleagues have really risen to the challenge as well, partly due to Legs Matter as well, because everybody's got together. But do you think there is a role here for podiatry? Because I'm sure there's podiatrists on this call at the moment, but we can't see them there. But podiatrists do say they look after the lower limb, but sometimes that lower limb seems to be below the ankle and not below the groin. So do you think this should be taking a bigger role in early identification of leg ulcers and management?
I think that, unfortunately, it'd be brilliant to try to understand where that misconception came, because as you know, and I know, the students within the podiatry school get taught everything all the way up to the hip. They are full people of the whole of the limb and experts in multiple things, gait, musculoskeletal issues, loading, the structure of the foot. They are experts in it all. I think that somehow within the NHS, we see them as a foot person. Mm. I certainly think the College of Podiatry are trying to tackle that perception. And I certainly work with many of my colleagues who I would class as lower limb experts, just as like I do. I think, though, you have to remember that we all come at it from a basis. You have a 4-year nursing degree and a 4-year podiatry degree. When you come out of that, who's the expert of the lower limb? Well, I'd say the podiatrist, because that's all they've concentrated on for 4 years, whereas nursing is so many different facets. I think when you start to specialise, those specialist nurses seem to escalate quite quickly to a specialist practitioner level. And I think it's about how do we break down those barriers by not being a specialist from your undergraduate course, but how do you actually step up to be a professional no matter what your profession? Pharmacy, podiatry, physiotherapist. And I do think that new world is emerging. And I do think actually the public understand that. I think now they understand. 10 years ago, it was a challenge if you walked into your GP's practice and you saw a nurse practitioner. There was a perception that you was going to get a lower service. I do think that perception has changed greatly over the last 10 years. And I think that a lot of that's down to the assurances from the university of the level of standard that you need to become an advanced care practitioner. You know, it's extremely regulated and the universities are very, very strict of who they allow to practice within that space. But from, I suppose, my major thing with all of this is not for patients or public to suffer in silence. You know, if you think there's something going on with your lower limb, start to question it. You're not a burden. I would much rather see you now when you've got very early signs and symptoms rather than you suffering for months and months and finally come to see me, because I hate elongated patient suffering that could have been avoidable. We know how to treat these conditions, and it's about really getting that the variation of clinical care across the UK standardised so every patient out there receives evidence-based practice. It's a challenge, but it's one that the NHS is prepared to face. You can see that by the work from the National Wound Care Strategy. You can see that by from educationalists like yourselves who's delivering tissue viability, lower limb specialist modules at master's level online. So anybody across the UK, in fact, anybody across the globe can access your education. But it's about really, if you have a patient out there or you are a patient, who do you first ring? Who do you first contact? And I think that point of call should be any healthcare professional that's prepared to listen. And if your first healthcare professional, you feel like you've been poo-pooed, dismissed, try again. Do not accept that blank ignorance with it. You know, if things are going wrong, you know your own body, really question why. Make sure you are speaking to somebody that you have confidence in. Having confidence with your clinician is the major one key. And I know many of you may not live locally, but we do have a fantastic podiatric drop-in clinic, don't we, Karen? Or is it booked by appointment clinic at the University of Huddersfield? So, you know, and that's run by podiatrists in training, but a lot of clinical academics too. So if you are local to Huddersfield, that's always another point of contact for you.
Leanne, talk about points of contact. We talked about like podiatrists, nurses, GPs and pharmacists as well. And I've noticed that more and more we see different products being sold over the counter now. So lotions, potions, plasters, but also stockings, so compression stockings, for example. How safe do you think it is for, say, if I said I got really sore aching legs and they're feeling a little bit itchy, can I go in the pharmacist and just pick any of these stockings up and not work and be thankful that they're going to work? Or are they going to cause me problems if I haven't seen somebody like you who's a specialist?
I think the first thing is to really try to unpick what is the underlying cause. And I think with the help of the information that's on the Legs Matters website, you will be able to tease out, am I more likely to be this or more likely to be this? I think discussing it with an over-the-counter pharmacist is always helpful. Whatever a pharmacy sells you is never going to do you any harm. But what I'd say is if it hasn't improved your symptoms within 2 weeks of using that product, using that stocking, having that level of treatment, if you know better after 2 weeks, then you need escalating up. You need an appropriate assessment with an accurate diagnosis. Because if you remember when I talked about problems with the arteries of too little blood getting down to the toes, sometimes compression garments can make that worse. Mostly they don't, but sometimes they can if they're too strong. If you think about problems with the veins, you desperately need compression garments to help to squeeze away all of that internal inflammation. And what I don't want patients to do is to be sold like I am if I walk into Debenhams, or used to walk into Debenhams, with all the lovely counters. Don't be walking to pharmacy and get perplexed by this dressing says it's going to do this, this dressing is going to be better than that dressing. Actually, there's very little evidence to say one dressing works more than the other. There is slightly for something called Ergo Start, but only slightly compared to the others. And I think that really what we need to be thinking about is how do you maintain that wound with first aid treatment, let's say, but only for 2 weeks. And if it's not showing signs of healing after 2 weeks, then you need to be escalated, especially if you're already looking at your leg and thinking, my leg's been swollen, now I've got a sore on it. I've had pain in this leg for ages, I've now got a sore on it. This toe's been freezing cold and it's now turning a bit black at the end. These all need urgent escalations.
Yeah, and I think it is about heightening people's awareness as well, Leanne, isn't it? To say exactly what you're saying, don't suffer in silence. You know your own body. And if you've developed these new aches and pains or discoloured toes, then seek help because, like say, you're not being a burden.
I've never seen a patient in my whole career that I thought has been a burden to me, not once. Because even if I see a patient and I'm able to diagnose there's no problems with the veins, there's no problems with the arteries and the lymphatic system's really well, I can reassure that patient. Surely that's a good use of my time. I can also give mini health promotion advice because wherever you go in the NHS, you should get this. We should be talking to you about regular exercise, smoking, stopping smoking, maintaining a healthy BMI. And as much as, you know, we're not being critical of you, it's just about that parrot being constantly picking at your head to say, we need to ensure that we've got healthy lifestyles and we're choosing healthy options. And we all need to be reminded of that. You know, we've been working from home. It's been a national pandemic. I will admit that I've put on weight and I'm drinking too much. Is that because I haven't had the GP picking at me with a regular intervention? So I think that we are all aware of what we need to do to maintain healthy lifestyles and healthy behaviours. Having that reinforced from a healthcare professional, we shouldn't ever view that of, here they go again, they're picking on me. All we're trying to do is to bring that to the forefront of your mind to hopefully cause an action in terms of a choosing a healthier lifestyle approach.
That's really interesting because my life is very healthy, as you know, Leanne, and I have no worries about anything. But what would you say would be the top tips for keeping your legs healthy at the moment? Because we know that we're all getting older, people living longer. So how should we be managing our own legs?
There's basically only two things that you need to do. Don't smoke. Don't become overweight. If you're able to do those two things, anything else, unfortunately, isn't down to you. It's down to genetics. I hate to say, if you looked at your mum's or dad's legs as you were growing older and saw they had terrible varicose veins, you're getting them no matter what. It's hereditary. If your mum and dad's got them, they're coming your way by the time you reach 50, if not younger. But in terms of how can you stop that perpetuating, having varicose veins with a significantly high BMI means that you'll have problems with the veins and the lymphatic drainage. You'll have more problems with inflammation. You are more likely to get problems with long-term issues such as leg ulceration. So I'm a pragmatic clinician. There are things that we can do and there's things that we can't do. You can't change your age. You can't change your genes. And you can't change your health predisposition, if you like. But you can choose not to smoke. You can drink alcohol in moderation and you can maintain a healthy BMI. I know it's a challenge for some patients more than the others, but the NHS is also there to help you with all those things. It's not simply us saying, bye-bye, it's up to you. We have multiple programs available to help patients in that. So I suppose it's my call to anybody out there. If you're listening to this and you've got some issues, please seek help. The NHS is open. We want to hear from you. I want to care for you. And I think if any clinicians are out there that's listening to this, please ensure that you are that clinician that you would like to see if you were that patient. Give that holistic management approach. Ensure that you can pinpoint that accurate diagnosis and be aware of evidence-based treatment pathways that you should be giving. We can't be masters of everything. If you don't know, simply use resources such as Legs Matters, such as the university, to be able to increase your knowledge and education or to signpost your patients to the best information.
Leanne, I think you've actually highlighted there as well the importance of having people like you, clinical academics, working with the university so very closely and being employed as, you know, on this 50-50 basis as well. Because I can do all the research, for example, and I can read the papers and I can talk to people, but we really need these clinical academics who can say like you, this is what I'm seeing every day. This is what the issues are. And this is how we can help, because you're up to date and you are expert in this area. And I think this shows things like Legs Matters work so well because people have got together and worked together and listened to the patients and listened to the staff as well.
And I also think from another point of view, Karen, with that, I also think it's really important for a nursing career. Many nurses don't want to leave a patient's bedside, but desperately want to progress. You know, there is a terrible level of ceiling that you've got to yourself that you become at the top of your clinical career. And actually, to move any further forward in your clinical career, you have to choose to move away from patients. That seems so wrong to me. I don't want a career where I don't see a patient. That's where my passion lives. So we have to make sure that we are grasping the future of our nursing workforce, the nurses that love their job still, that deliver the best patient care, that can feed into research, but can be the passionate educators that university needs to ensure we're maintaining those highest of education standards.
Yeah, and I think it's all healthcare professionals as well. I think that's why the Institute works so well, because we're very much aware of, we can have the host as the university, but everybody else feeds in and everybody else is listened to equally as much, because without research, we don't improve clinical practice. Without clinical practice, we don't know what research needs to be done to be able to improve it, all underpinned by education. But Leanne, I think I'm going to have to be quiet for a minute because there's loads and loads of questions coming in from the audience, which is aimed at either you or me, but hopefully you. But Nick has all the questions, so I'll hand over to Nick at this point.
Yeah, thanks so much. It was so informative. I'm not sure. I think you've certainly touched on some of the questions that have come in. But for people who are in the audience, please keep posting questions and we'll see what we can do. There's still a fair bit of time that we can get through, certainly more than a couple of questions. One thing, Leanne, really helpful, fairly simple advice: don't smoke, maintain a healthy weight. There was a question about exercise and whether exercise itself was important in terms of lower leg health.
Movement is important. And I think that when I talk about exercise with patients, they think of putting on their lycra, going out for a jog or going to the gym. And I think that we really need to be wary of that word exercise. And from a patient point of view, absolutely, if you can hit the gym 3 times a week, you'll maintain a good BMI, you'll have masses of muscle mass, fantastic. So if you can get there, fine. Exercise of any description is important though, and when I talk about exercise, I'm actually talking about movement. So it's about actually choosing not to be sedentary. Many of my patients who are extreme BMIs, who have real problems with movement, I simply ask them every time an advert comes on, walk up the stairs and down the stairs again. And it's about thinking about where are you at this moment with movement and exercise, and where do you want to go? If all you are is walking around your house at this moment in time, you're not going to do couch to 5K. I don't care who you are. But you can actually start to do those little interventions. Even, you know, the whole old-fashioned policeman raises, where you simply lift the heels off the back of the floor. Actually just moving your feet, if you just sat in a chair and you can't actually mobilize, moving your feet, rounding your ankles, all of these are fantastic exercises. So Legs Matters website has got exercises on there, all the way from, if you like, a chair-bound patient, all the way up to an active patient. But it's just about really setting yourself a miniature goal and really rewarding yourself when you get there. But exercise is vital for everything. And especially as you get older, when you start to lose your muscle mass, it's very, very difficult to get back. And once you've lost your muscle mass, that's when you'll become weak, frail, and subject to falls and fractured neck of femurs and a terrible spiral. And when I talk about muscle mass, it's about simple things. If you're 75 and you're sat in your chair, just get yourself moving your arms up and down, you will maintain your muscle mass of your upper body. But it's just about thinking about that every day and how you can embed exercise as a regular intervention. It's not something you should be thinking about doing twice a week. It's something really minimum exercise or minimum movement we should be thinking about doing every single day of our lives.
Okay.
Leanne, sorry, Nick, can I just say that I think Leanne's made such a good point here that we forget about, that we talk to patients or we talk to each other even and say, oh, I could do with a bit more exercise, and you haven't moved more than 100 yards for the last 10 years. And then suddenly you think, right, I'm going to do the 5K run in the park. We need to make sure people understand it's taking it slowly, because you will injure yourself even worse.
Not only that though, Karen, you'll get defeatism straight away. If you ask me to run 5K myself, I don't run, good grief. You know, I would say, no, I can't do it. I'm a defeatist. I'm not even going to try. So it's about really looking at patient activation in a different way of setting meaningful goals. And the best way to do that is actually ask the patient simply, what would you like to be able to do in 2 weeks from now? Most of the patients will say, I'd just like to be able to walk upstairs without getting breathless. Right then, how can we get you to that? And it's about making meaningful goals to that individual.
It's realism, isn't it? That this is a realistic goal. And also, I don't run either, Leanne. And my philosophy is that people that have broken ankles are those that have run, not people like you and I that have walked places.
No, sorry, but we, Nick.
So we've talked a little bit about prevention. Can I talk about some of the stepping into kind of early signs potentially? So talking about, there's a question about nighttime foot cramps and any remedies, and also tingling leg pain at night, which I know you talked about earlier on, but could you say more about that, how people might kind of manage those kind of symptoms?
Okay, so tingling on a night time and muscular cramps is nothing to be worried about. You tend to find that you would get tingling of your foot in a daytime as well, if it was associated with arteries and furring up of the arteries. Or you would get significant pain. So simply tingling is probably nothing to do with the arteries, probably more likely to do with the nerves. And therefore, that can be linked to normal muscular cramping. And that's just to simply due to the amount of lactic acid that's inside the muscle. If it is just happening within the muscle and when you're in bed on a night time, I would try some quick, easy remedies. There is some more information, though, in terms on the website about cramping of the legs, because I think it's really important that we do ensure it's not a problem with the arteries. And there is some questions you can ask yourself to say whether that is a case or not. If you think it's normal muscular pain, that you can feel your calf knotting up and your toes starting to cross, a great remedy for that to start off with is simple, a glass of tonic water. Indian tonic water contains quinine. It can help the release of or the movement of lactic acid within the muscle. You can get that on a tablet through your GP, but I think many of us would just prefer to have a glass of tonic water. Just to make sure your tonic water on the back, it will say caution, contains quinine. And actually that's what you want. And a glass of tonic water each night can help tremendously with simple muscular cramps. But just to reiterate, we need to make sure that those cramps are muscular related, not anything else related. And the Legs Matters website will help to tease out those symptoms for you.
Okay, thanks. And then moving on to veins, there's a question about spider veins, how best to prevent varicose veins. And then also, say for patients who can't tolerate compression, what would the recommendations be for venous type things?
Okay, so varicose veins is a range of symptoms, and we started off with the smallest ones, if you like, in terms of clinical indication, being spider veins. Spider veins are those that look just like a purple spider's web, often behind the ankle bone. They become more prominent as you get older because your skin becomes more translucent. So they seem to be more present, but in fact, they've always been there. They've just been behind some very nice, healthy, hydrated skin. Spider veins is nothing to worry about at all, and it's probably not going to get any worse than what it is. They are treated as cosmetic within the NHS. There are treatments for you, but they are only available privately. And for spider veins, it's unsightly. We can simply inject the vein with some foam that fills the vein, because actually what you're seeing is the blood within the vein. So if we fill the vein with a translucent substance, you can't see the blood, so the vein just disappears. So treatment of spider veins is private only. It's cosmetic. Don't worry about them if they're not causing you any trouble. If they are causing you any, if you are embarrassed, seek private intervention for those. As the veins become more problematic, you can then become varicose veins. So this is the ones that tend to run down the inside of the thigh towards the knee and along the back of the leg too. And these are the ones that look chunky, and often you can see prominent valves within the veins, and it does look like a big a blood worm really running down the back of your leg. But varicose veins can be there and they can be asymptomatic, in other words, not giving you any problems at all. If so, who cares? If it's not bothering you, there's nothing that needs to be done. Asymptomatic varicose vein treatment is not available on the NHS because, again, we see it as cosmetic. However, if the varicose veins start to cause you symptoms in terms of venous insufficiency, so there's pooling of blood, so high pressures within the veins, that's when you start to get a range of symptoms. And those symptoms can start with tired and achy legs, worse after periods of standing, worse if for women during their menstrual cycle. You can then start to get changes of the tissues, of the colour and the sensation around the ankle. You can get deposits of edema, and that's the range of symptoms that the NHS treats. Treatment for varicose veins, according to NICE, which is the National Institute of Clinical Recommendations that we all should work into, is actually not the use of compression garments in the first instance. The actual for treatment of symptomatic veins in the first instance is what we call ablation of the veins. It's a minimally invasive day case procedure available in multiple vascular centres. You come into a treatment room, they numb an area of skin, they put a catheter within the vein, they burn the vein off with some lasers or some heat therapy, and you can walk back out again. That collapses the vein, removes that pressure within that vein, and basically turns off the tap. You don't have to worry about the circulation because we're only treating the superficial veins, and you've got a deep venous system that's going to return all the blood. But that can turn off that high pressure, therefore getting rid of all of those symptoms of edema, painful, achy legs, or colour discoloration. And you certainly, if you have symptomatic varicose veins, you should be seeking an opinion of a vascular specialist to look into that in the first instance. If you don't fancy any of that I've talked about, and further information about all of that is available on the website, you can treat the symptoms of varicose veins with compression garments, and they can be very, very beneficial. But they're only as good as what you wear them. So you have to wear your compression garments every day that you are stood up. At the end of the day, the human is a spirit level and we are affected by gravity. As soon as we stand up, the pressure within our lower limbs increases substantially. And if your veins aren't coping with that higher pressure, it's at that point you need a compression garment on to be able to cope with that. Remember as well, some patients do suffer from chronic lymphatic changes such as lymphedema. And unfortunately for lymphedema, there is no known easy corrective treatment for that. Those patients do need to be in lifelong compression garments, but there are many brilliant lymphedema nurses available. So if you've got problems with chronic swelling of your legs, you need to make sure that you've got an accurate diagnosis of lymphedema and that you're seeing the most appropriate lymphedema specialist.
Okay, so say someone has got problematic varicose veins, who should they go to first? Where's the best point of contact first?
The best point of contact is anybody within their GP surgery. So that could be a nurse practitioner, it could be a practice nurse if she's able to do onward referrals, or it could be a GP within there. And you should be arming yourself with information from the Legs Matters website and the NICE guidelines for varicose veins. So therefore, if you go to that GP and they say, we don't do treatments for that, you're able to provide evidence to say, oh, the NHS does.
Okay, we've got time for a couple more questions. There's a couple of questions about sores and ulcers, actually. So one is about why diabetics have to take particular care of their feet.
Because unfortunately, diabetes is one of the worst diseases out there. It affects so many parts of our body, and it affects the micro elements of the body. And this is the problem with diabetes, especially with patients with diabetes on their feet, because what happens is the diabetes will change two things. It will change the circulation, not from the major arteries, but from those small arteries and arterioles right down to the presence of the toe. So we can start with diminished circulation. But on top of that, the diabetes affects the nerve supply. So therefore, we can actually dampen down the nerve response, especially of the peripheries. So if me and you stood on or stubbed a toe, we'd have pain, brilliant response, a protective response. And we'd also have perfect circulation to be able to cope with those things. If you are a diabetic, you may stub your toe and not have that pain. So you haven't had that recognition, I need to keep an eye on my toe. Plus that you've got changes to the microcirculation. So you could go from a very tiny knock or sore on your foot to a wound, to a diabetic infection, because remember that the breeding ground for bacteria loves extra sugar. And if you're a diabetic, you've got extra sugar within your bloodstream. And unfortunately, diabetic foot infection is extremely common, and this is the major reason why patients have major amputations within the NHS. And that's why anybody that's a diabetic, we urge you all to check your feet on a daily basis to look at those signs and symptoms. And if you're noticing you're getting early changes, that your toe ends feel cold or your nerve sensation is being reduced, it's a warning sign. It's telling you to pay heedance to your diabetic control to stop that journey that you're on. Because unfortunately, it doesn't just affect the sensation and the blood supply to the feet, but also to the eyes, to the kidneys. And these are things obviously needed to keep you here on earth more than anything else. So we need to make sure that we're paying great heedance with the whole holistic care of a patient that's got diabetes. It's a terrible diagnosis. It one that if you have been diagnosed with type 2 diabetes, it really is a wake-up call to look at your health choices and really think about how can you be majorly good to prevent those onward problems that currently you're facing.
Okay. Leanne, as well, there's about checking your feet daily. I think it's very important as well during the summer months, because we find a lot of the younger diabetic people with diabetes or middle-aged who are going away on holiday forget about the diabetes and forget about checking the feet and end up burning the feet on the sand. And we've seen some horrendous burns, haven't we, Leanne, and wounds caused by people going on holiday, flicking the flip-flops off, running down the beach and not even realise that they've burnt the soles of the feet.
Okay, thanks. There's one more question, last question from a student orthotist who's joined us this evening, who tends to see unhealthy lower limbs, sores, ulcers, calluses, etc. And is there anything you could suggest to stop these from recurring from wearing orthoses, from wearing devices?
Well, I'm so glad that they posed their question, because I suppose the only professional I haven't mentioned and the importance of their role is from the orthotists. So orthotists are people that are really skilled in the biomechanics of the foot, the loading pressures of the foot, and our feet are designed to load pressures in a certain way. If you have any problems in terms of diabetes, where you've got changes of the tendons or changes of the formation of the joints, anything like arthritis or any congenital issues or any trauma to your feet, the way that you load pressure on your foot changes. And that can have significant consequences, because you shouldn't be high loading on certain areas. The beauty of the orthotist is that they can actually make bespoke footwear to redistribute that pressure across the foot. And that can help with multiple things. pain when you're walking. It can help with your gait of how you walk. It can help with your confidence in terms of falling, especially if you've lost the absent sensation when you're actually walking with your feet. So the orthotists play a huge, huge role. I think if anybody's interested in terms of how do they develop their career more in terms of this student, and I would urge you to make links with your diabetic multidisciplinary team. Most diabetic multidisciplinary teams are crying out for skilled orthotists in this area. We're fortunate within Mid-Yorks that we have a couple of fantastic orthotists, but it really, really helps. And a lot of that is to do with early prevention. And it's about how do we get patients to be seen by the appropriate person. I don't believe orthotists take direct referrals, but I may be wrong. But I certainly know your podiatrist can refer on to your orthotic specialist. So being seen by a regular podiatrist can really help your foot health.
Thank you. And a reminder that there is a podiatry clinic at the university, which I have been a patient of. Excellent service. So thanks so much. This has been unbelievably informative, and I hope the audience has got plenty out of it. So thanks both to Karen and to Leanne for tonight's webinar. I hope everyone's found it as interesting as I have. It was a really important discussion, touching on some very serious things, but also some very sound practical advice. It'd be great if people could complete just a short survey about the webinar. We do like to improve things as we go along, so all of your comments will take very seriously. You'll find the feedback form there in the chat. The seminar series is the public lecture series is jointly shared with the School of Applied Sciences, another school within the university, and the next session from Applied Sciences, as you can see there, is on the 3rd of March at 6 o'clock. Earth observation, the way to see global environmental change, sounds interesting. A look from on high, perhaps. So I'd urge you to come along to that if you're interested. And then we have another event on the 11th of March to commemorate International Women's Day, which is on, I believe, is on the 8th of March. But we're holding the meeting, the seminar, on the 11th of March at 5 o'clock. And the title of that is Who Needs Feminism? Which is one of our Professor Emerita, Valerie Bryson, will be here. We'll be joined by Julie Hesmond-Hold, who many of you will know from Coronation Street, but also through her activism. Kim Ledbetter, MBE, and our own Professor Adele Jones, OBE, and Dr. Georgina Blakely, who both of whom work within the School of Human and Health Sciences. So I hope we see you there. And if you want to find out more about our events, then if you want to join the mailing list, then contact Li Ji Yang. The address is here. Or follow us on Twitter if you do that, at Research is Ace. So thank you so much for joining us. Please visit the Institute website and get in touch with Karen if you want to know more about the research that happens here. So thank you so much.
Thank you.